Good morning. I welcome you all here to worship on our third Sunday of Advent. I am taking the place of pastor. He is on vacation today, although you will see him here physically. He is still taking a vacation day. Mother Nature dampened their travel plans as they were going to travel to a family wedding. But due to that beautiful blanket of snow out there, their plans changed. But nonetheless, he is still on vacation, and worship must go on. So I welcome you, all friends and family, to worship this morning. If you will turn to the back of your bulletin, you'll take a note of the announcements today. Please, you are all welcome to stay for the soup luncheon. This is a benefit of our Savers Lutheran youth. This free will donation will help raise funds for them to go to, they're going to the youth gathering later on, coming up in a couple years, so that money will go toward that. The worship service can be seen on our local cable TV venture channel on 195 this Wednesday at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m., and as always on the YouTube, Our Savers Lutheran Church. The December special offering will be held next Sunday, December 18th. It will go to the Lutheran Campus Ministry. Women's group reminder that Valora Season and Liz Tevedal are down for the month of December to help with communion, and Group 4 is responsible for washing the communion cups. Two indoor Christmas caroling opportunities. As we enjoy a little preview of winter weather to come, you are invited to take part in two indoor Christmas caroling opportunities. Saturday at 4:30 p.m. at Sweetgrass, they will host the Cocoa Cider and Carols, and that's a follow-up to the Suds and Sarsaparilla and Song event that was held there in October. And then on Sunday at 2:45, the worship service at the West Kona Manor will be a lesson of carols for Christmas, including readings and music by family members. So again, we welcome you to worship, and we will get started this morning with our Advent candle lighting.
This is the third week of Advent. We light our third candle, the candle of joy. Jesus' birth and early ministry gives us reason to be joyful. He came to save us from our sins and bring us back to God.
Let us read responsibly. God, as we draw near to the celebration of Jesus' birth, fill us with joy and gladness. Help us to share the good news of Jesus' birth with others. Amen. Please stand as you are able and join in the hymn, Prepare the Royal Highway.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the beginning was the Word.
And the Word was God.
In the Word was life.
And the life was the light of all people.
The Word became flesh and lived among us.
And we have seen his glory, full of grace and truth.
Let's respond together the prayer of the day. Lord, hear our prayers and come to us, bringing light into the darkness of our hearts. For you live and reign with the Father of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. This morning, our first reading comes from Isaiah chapter 35, verses 1 through 10. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with the joy in singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless shall sing for joy. For water shall break forth in the wilderness, and the streams in the desert, and the burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp, and the grass shall become reeds and rushes. A highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not travel on it, but it shall be for God's people. No traveler, not even fools, shall go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come upon it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to the Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Will you please read the psalm responsively with me? Our psalm this morning is found in 146, verses 4 through 9. Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help, whose hope is in the Lord their God. Who gives justice to those who are oppressed, and food to those who are hungry? The Lord loves the righteousness. The Lord cares for the stranger. He sustains the orphan and the widow, but frustrates the way of the wicked. Our second reading this morning comes from James chapter 5, verses 7 through 10. Be patient, therefore, beloved, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious crops from the earth, being patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains. You must also be patient. Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Beloved, do not grumble against one another, so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. As an example of suffering and patience, beloved, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Will you please rise and sing the gospel acclamation?
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 11th chapter. When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised. And the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. In preparation of Pastor being gone today, he has created a video that we will see now for the sermon.
Have you ever been in the grocery store or on the street or somewhere around town and you run into someone, maybe it's the new doctor that you just met, or the banker, or even the new pastor in town, and they're dressed differently than how you're used to seeing them, and you don't recognize them?
As a pastor, when I'm new in a community and used to seeing certain people in their Sunday clothes, and then I go and see them in their work clothes, I may not recognize them for who they are. I used to wonder how simply putting on a pair of glasses allowed Superman to hide his identity. I mean, glasses? Really? But there evidently is research to indicate that that's a pretty good disguise. I don't know, what do you think? Do I look different without my glasses? I think I look older. We're getting ready to celebrate Jesus' birth. But this morning, we have a story from Matthew's gospel from when Jesus was all grown up and just starting his ministry. John the Baptist didn't have a picture of what the Messiah would look like, a physical picture. He had scripture, but he was still, I think, scratching his head a little bit. And so he sent his followers, his disciples, to Jesus to ask him, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we look for another?" There are people still today who would like to ask Jesus that question. Are you really who you're supposed to be, or should we look for someone else? And there are others who, not getting a suitable answer, look elsewhere. They fail to recognize Jesus for who he is, maybe in part because they've not heard the story, they've not read the scripture about him, or if they have, maybe they haven't seen the types of signs in their life that are supposed to accompany the Savior. They may not have experienced the healing of body and mind and spirit that Jesus is reputed to have granted. They may not have experienced him as good news to the poor if they're struggling to make a living. And to be honest, not everybody in Jesus' time did either. Jesus didn't heal everybody. There were still poor people around. People still died, including Jesus. But wherever Jesus went, miraculous things happened. The miracles were not Jesus' reason for coming to this earth, but they were signs that God himself was among us. Wherever Jesus went, people's lives were changed for the better. Of that, the Bible is clear, and we can be certain. So how do we recognize Jesus today if he's not out there walking among us? And how do we prepare for his return? Some have suggested that we do the things that he did so that other people might see Jesus in us. That's not a bad idea. If we recognize the kinds of things that Jesus did while he walked this earth and do them, then others just might see him in us. Problem is, I've not really done a lot of the kinds of miracles that Jesus did. I have, however, read to a blind seminary student so that she could keep up with her assignments and pursue her calling to become a pastor. Here in this congregation, we recently purchased some new hearing assist devices to allow people to hear what's going on in worship better. Out there this morning, there might be a physical therapist or a nurse who has helped someone walk again after a serious illness or injury. There might be doctors or nurses that have helped provide healing. There might even have been somebody who, through CPR or some other means, have brought someone back from the dead. And even if you've not done these things, if you pay attention to where they are happening, there you will find the Christ. Even if these things are not happening to you or because of you, where they are happening, Jesus has promised to be. On the other hand, Jesus did not heal everybody when he walked this earth. There were people who died on his watch, as I said. Because of that, we can also be sure that we will see him where there are sick and dying people, where there are poor and oppressed people, because he has promised to be there among them also. Jesus died to prove that, and he rose again to show his power over all of that. The message of Advent and Christmas is that God came to be among us to experience everything that we will experience. All the pain and the suffering, as well as the healing, all the sorrow and the joy, all the death and all the life. So that wherever we go and whatever we experience, we will know that Jesus is there too. He was born into this world to give the world a glimpse, however fleeting, of how things might be under God's rule, and to show God's power over this earth and all the things of this earth. And he will come again to bring light and healing to all of life, forever removing the darkness that can so often oppress you and me. I invite you, as we prepare for the coming of the Christ child, to put on new lenses of faith, so that you might see in new and surprising places and some old and familiar ones the coming of the Christ. Especially this morning, as we hear sung and told the story of that coming anew. Jesus is the one and only Messiah, the Savior. Prepare to see him anew. Amen.
Please stand to share out with amongst each other the hymn of the day, All Earth is Hopeful, and it will be found in the Blue Book with One Voice, page 629.
Thank you.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Like streams in the desert, may the church everywhere overflow with the bold proclamation and loving service for the sake of the world. O giver of hope, like the blind made to see, may the eyes of the world leaders and each of us be open to the plight of those who live in warring nations, those who are victims of natural disasters, and those who live without hope. O giver of hope, like those who followed John the Baptist, may we heed the voices of the prophet who are courageous in their witness to the word and the will of God, lifting up justice above comfort and the poor above the rich. O giver of hope, like the lame who leap as deer, may those who suffer be renewed. Comfort those who are ill or in special need, especially Audrey Edwards. O giver of hope, like the wilderness that rejoices with singing, may this congregation proclaim the glory of the Lord through the arts and the music. O giver of hope, in unity with the redeemed who now walk with the giver, with God forever, we offer our thanks and praises for those who have died in the faith. May we be inspired by their witness. O giver of hope, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please pass the peace with those around you, and the Sunday school children are dismissed to line up. Later then. What? Yeah. I thought they were lining up back there.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth, sea, and skies were covered with darkness until God spoke.
God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. The sun filled the heavens by day, and moon and stars brightened the night.
Long after the dawn of creation, God promised another light, a light that would shine through the eyes of a child, a light that would bring hope and love to a world darkened by sin.
Jesus, light of the world, hope and salvation.
Old Testament prophets predicted the Messiah's birth. They said he would be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Prince of Peace. The true light that could give light to everyone was coming into the world.
But when would he come? Where would people find him? How would they know he was the true light?
How would we know if the light came today? Would we take time to watch? Would we stop to listen? Or would we just be too busy to notice?
When the time was near, an angel appeared to Mary and said,
"Do not be afraid, for I have found favor with God. You will give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel, which means God with us."
An angel also appeared to Joseph, reassuring him that the child to come was sent from the Holy Spirit.
Mary and Joseph knew the light was coming into the world.
They had to travel to Bethlehem so they could register for the census. They arrived there after a long journey, and the time came for the baby to be born.
The town was full, and there was no room in the inn for Mary and Joseph to stay the night. Where would they go? Where would this child be born?
The only place for them to stay was in a stable with the animals. How could the Son of God be born in such a place? Surely a king would not be found here.
But there in a manger, the baby Jesus was born. In the midst of that dark night, God sent light into the world.
Right.
There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night.
An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified.
Do not be afraid. I bring you good tidings of great joy. Today in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord.
And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill to all.
God promised so long ago had finally come into the world.
The shepherds had heard the news from the angels, and they wanted to go see the Son of God for themselves.
But what about their sheep out in the fields? Who would watch them if the shepherds left? Would the shepherds really be able to find Jesus anyway? How would they know where to go?
Despite these questions, the shepherds had faith, and when the angels left them, they said to one another, Let's go to Bethlehem and see this miracle that has happened. Others saw the star too. Magi visiting from the east saw the light in the sky and traveled to Bethlehem to find the baby Jesus.
God used the star to lead them across many lands so they could find the true light, Jesus Christ.
When the When they found the Savior, the Magi rejoiced and presented him with precious gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
For the shepherds and the Magi, this was just the beginning of the story. As they journeyed back to their homes, they took the news of Jesus' birth with them.
Our story begins here, too, and we have seen the light that God has sent for us. We have heard the good news of the Savior's birth.
So now we take this light and hold it high, sharing the hope and love of Jesus Christ wherever we go. The Savior is born. Let his light shine.
Thank you.
And a continued applause for Mrs. Fosnot for organizing this today. Kids, you may go back and sit with your parents and get ready for the noisy offering. If you are visiting us today, the kids do participate in offering. They bring coins up and we'll dump those into the can. So if you are a visitor, again, your child can participate in the offering. We'll go back to the offertory prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you embrace our lives with your great love for humanity. With joy and gladness, we ask that these gifts may be for many a sign of that love and that we may continue to share in your divine life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Go in peace, serve the Lord,